It's not unusual for a young model to be discovered on the pages of a magazine and overnight thrust into the Hollywood spotlight. That's exactly what happened to Lauren Bacall in 1943 when a director's wife spotted her and knew she was going to be a star.
But who could have predicted what good fortune that first role would bring, thrusting her into not only Hollywood's eye, but into the arms of Humphrey Bogart.
As the years would follow, Bacall became a legendary star of both stage and screen. What's she doing these days? Well, that's what she shares in her new book, Lauren Bacall Now. And please welcome Ms. Lauren Bacall.
Welcome to Detroit. Well, we're going to hear what Lauren Bacall is up to now when we come back, so please stay with us.
What'd you do that for?
Been wondering whether I'd like it.
What's the decision?
Even better when you help. Sure you won't change your mind about this?
Uh-huh.
This belongs to me and so do my lips. I don't see any difference.
Oh, I do.
Okay. You know you don't have to act with me, Steve. You don't have to say anything and you don't have to do anything. Not a thing. Oh, maybe just whistle. You know how to whistle, don't you, Steve? You just put your lips together and blow.
It's hot stuff. My.
I'll tell you, it's hot stuff.
Well, that was the beginning of what has become a really incredible career. But this book, Lauren Bacall Now, really focuses on just that, now. So what is the top priority for Lauren Bacall Now?
Staying alive.
Okay.
It's like a good one.
That's first.
And just continuing. Just going on, continuing to work, which is, of course, one of the most important things that, in my life. Keeps me going, keeps the blood coursing through my veins, and keeps me interested. And trying to stay healthy, I suppose, because without that, you really don't have anything.
You said that this book you were telling backstage that this isn't about...
It's not a Hollywood book. Well, my autobiography was not a Hollywood book either. But this is not a sequel to By Myself. It is not a continuation of my life. It is not a chronological continuation of my life. It really is, over the last 15 years, kind of where I've been a little bit and what has led me to now. As far as perceptions and misconceptions and my feelings about my friends, about friends that have lost, that I've lost, about my children and travel and work and kind of life in general, and also what do I do with the rest of it, which better be about another 50 years.
We expect, at least.
We have a feeling that she's going to be around for another 50 years.
You know that you would expect us to start with your loves. You know, if we're talking about your life, can we start with some of your loves?
Why?
I don't know. It just seems the logical place.
You
know,
way to go, Nikki.
I really want to ask you, if you just had this hour to tell it, you tell it in your way, in whatever form, and you know, because they got things down here like, oh, let's talk about being single for 25 years, and oh, you've been married twice, and oh, a real love affair with Bogey. But I'm not going to stand up here and tell you, know, try to,
yeah,
you
but
say
that's
what you
good, thank you. Thank yeah, because
oh boy, I'm doing good so far, aren't I? Oh
yes,
boy,
you are. it's a fight to the finish for me to discuss really what is important to me as far as my life is concerned and my work is concerned and what I have done in my life without focus constantly being on that terrific scene that you just saw. That, I mean, it's a wonderful scene, and I suppose when I die, that is the scene that will be shown, and that will be all that will be my life.
That kiss will be the whole life, and that pucker up and glow will be your whole life.
Right? I guess so. But and it was a hell of a big part of my life, God knows, and very important. But after all, for 35 years, I've been functioning alone. I have been married again. I have another child whom I adore, and I've been on the stage. I've been in 3 hit shows. I had a whole theatrical career that I never had before. And I've written 2 books and been in a lot of movies. So I have had a life in addition to that life. Although that life will always be a part of me, obviously, because it was so important. So I want the accent to be on now, which is why I called it now, because I really don't live in the past. I mean, the past is you carry with you anyway. And I'm happy to have it with me. And I do refer to it quite often, but it's not my whole life. Okay. And so I moved to the present because, you know, I don't know if you ever saw Dennis Potter's interview on television. Dennis Potter was a man, an English writer, who wrote Pennies from Heaven, which was the original Pennies from Heaven, which was a television series, and then wrote The Singing Detective. I don't know if you ever saw it. It was shown on public television. The interview has been shown many, many times on public television. He died of cancer. He gave this interview 2 weeks before he died. It was the most extraordinary interview I've ever seen in my life. The man was just brilliant. It was the most life-affirming interview given by this man who was not going to live very long and knew it. And he said, the past is over. Tomorrow has not happened yet. There is just the nowness of life. And I agree with that. That's what there is. We spend so much time saying, what about tomorrow, that today is missed. And yesterday was yesterday.
Do you really look forward to tomorrow like you can hardly wait to see what's going to happen?
Well, I can hardly wait to see what's going to happen today. 5 minutes. No, I really think that we lose a lot. I think we lose a lot of time, and as you get older, you have less time to lose. So I don't want it all to disappear. I don't want to just have it only think about tomorrow. I want to really get the most out of today that I can.
You've been flying kind of solo since, what, 1969?
Yes, since my divorce. Yes. Well, I haven't been married.
No, but you've been kind of alone.
Well, not all the time.
I would say not this
well.
You say not all the time.
Not all the time. Mm-hmm. Don't you think, though, there's a difference between being alone and being lonely?
Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. No, I mean, I think everybody has moments of loneliness. Yeah. And to be lonely in a marriage, I think, is the worst kind of loneliness. I'm lonely occasionally. I think traveling can be lonely because
it's lonely
hotel
on the road.
Rooms all the time. But not this kind of traveling, not book touring, but I mean, when you're on tour of the show. But other than that, yes, being alone there are a lot of perks to being alone. I mean, I think most people need time alone. And my work involves so many people that I'm always with people that I need that quiet time. And I find also I would rather be alone than to go out just to go out. I don't want to just go out with some guy, you know, and listen, be bored to death.
You don't have trouble meeting men, though.
I have trouble finding men. They're singing my song, okay, yeah.
Right. They're all around, but what do they want?
They're all around? Around
they're all
where?
Over the place. Where they want.
Are they really? Oh.
Well. Yeah, I don't think so either. That's it. I don't think they're all around.
I don't think so, no.
It's hard to know.
No, I don't know whether we're talking about the same thing.
Oh,
Oh, yeah, I think we are. I think we are.
Didn't you go around with, I mean, haven't you dated, I heard this.
Don't believe it.
I know. You talked about misconceptions. I understand that because there's a lot of misconceptions about a lot of it.
Yeah.
But you have dated a lot of younger men.
Yes.
Tell
and
us
I
about
shall continue
that.
To aim. But
oh,
no. I like that.
Uh-huh. No, well, it's because I find older men very settled and quite boring. And, well, most of
and
the ones that
And we can think
I've
of
met,
some other things, too, can't we, you
yes,
and I?
Yes, that they are.
No, but I find that they are. Also, I find that they're much happier with younger women.
Isn't that
young
like
20-year-olds?
Right.
Yeah, with really young girls that make them feel
the
important.
What's with men today?
A lot.
You only have like 45 minutes.
No. It's been years, a lot.
Yeah.
We could go on for the whole show, I think, couldn't we? We could just talk about
Listen,
men.
There are some great men, but they're all taken.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know where the others are. I wish they'd show their faces.
Well, and do you hear, I'm sure you hear, you know, oh, they would be afraid of you or... You're intimidating, and as my mother would say,
yes.
If they're intimidated by you, you don't want to be bothered with them in the
right.
first place.
Oh, your mother's right. Absolutely correct.
It,
because it's again, preconceptions. People have ideas of what you are. Mm-hmm. Through the as what I am, through the roles I've played, they think that's what I am. Miss Independent, Miss in Control, I don't need anybody. Well, you know, I mean, if they were adult and knew enough about human beings mm-hmm. and about mm-hmm. life, they would realize that nobody is that sure of themselves. Right. And that, I mean, it might be just interesting to have a conversation. They don't know how to have a conversation. It's either flirting, you know, promising everything mm-hmm. and delivering nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, if they don't want to just... I mean, the only thing that interests me is to have a relationship where I've got to be able to talk to someone.
Mm-hmm.
And I find there's a great lack of humor.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't live without humor.
I read that you mm-hmm. see humor in just about everything about
I
your
do.
Life
it's
and
It's all
people.
A big joke to me.
Yeah, that's tragedy and humor. It's
the only
together,
way.
Don't they?
But it's
really?
The only
yeah.
way. I mean, you can't. I can't imagine life without laughter. And I think it gets you through a lot of other stuff. And I think that. I mean, it's like so many things are music cues to me. I mean, I hear people say something and I think of a song. And it's just, I have always lived that way. And I think part of it is due to the fact that I have been alone a good deal. And I have built up a way of dealing with the outside world in a way that has not been planned or thought
mm-hmm.
out, but it's
mm-hmm.
just kind of happened. Because I've never had PR people or flunkies, you know, who were preceding me and paving the way for me to see that everything worked out fabulously
like
for
your
me.
People.
So I've
mm-hmm.
always done it myself,
mm-hmm.
which has gotten me into a lot of trouble, of course, because I usually say what I think, and that always gets me into trouble.
Love it.
Anyway.
You know, and
there
then
you have it.
You know, I want to talk about something coming up, Predaporter,
mm-hmm.
which is the movie that's going to be released in December.
Right, Christmas.
I understand. Now, this is where I'm
Do
going
you?
Really
you
get
I'm glad
right
you're
now.
Taking the chances. I'm not starting any sentence what I understand or I know. I'm starting all sentences, you're noticing with, do
well,
you?
Well, I'm just jumping in here. I'm just going to jump
it,
in.
Go for it,
Marilyn. I hear.
Go for it.
She's not going to sign my book. She may sign yours, but she won't sign
I'm hoping.
At Predaporter, there was a lot of problems on the set. A lot of...
Who said? Uh-oh.
I read it.
Well, I have to tell you, that
tell me,
article...
Misconception.
That hateful Vanity Fair article.
I know
you
that.
Know what
Vanity Fair
referring to.
Article
mm-hmm.
is filled with lies.
Okay.
And I can tell you that Robert Altman and Miramax, not to mention myself, are furious about it.
Mm-hmm.
Because this woman was on the set. A lot of the stuff that she had written for the movie had been changed, not been used.
Mm-hmm.
And she chose to be bitchy in the article
oh.
and be vicious. She wrote... Most of the stuff she wrote about me was absolutely untrue. But she used me in the article.
She
so I'm featured in the article
as
being
yeah,
the heavy, which
vehicle.
Of course is easy for people to believe because I have a deep voice and because I've been accused of being the heavy for years. And another misconception, which I'm afraid I will never be able to get away from.
And
right.
do you get used to that? It's
no,
a misconception.
Never.
And doesn't it still hurt? Or
yes.
does it hurt?
Well, it angers me a great deal. In a situation like this, where there were 30 actors on the set, and this woman chose to single me out.
You.
Mm-hmm. Really infuriated me.
Mm-hmm.
In addition to which, I barely ever had anything to do with her. So whatever she wrote, she heard mm-hmm. somehow, or she made up, or she absolutely enlarged upon it to such a degree that it was totally exaggerated.
But how do you ever retaliate to stuff like that?
I mean, you can't.
Been written about
I'll tell you, there's no point.
I'll tell you, we have reams of things that have been written about you. We have read them. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of misconceptions, like she's hard to get along with.
Like what?
Like she's hard to get along with. Like... I'm playing the heavy
I'm
here today.
I'm moving my chair. That's right. You can have it, too.
No, but there are. And you know what? I just knew you'd be great. And you are great, isn't she? I mean, she's fun. And I heard from our makeup person, too. That you were
well,
just
you know,
really
I mean,
a dear. You're
I tell you, in a way, I am hard to get along with because I'm very demanding.
You say what's on your mind.
Well, not only that, but I mean, I demand 150% of myself. And I demand the same from my friends and my children. And everyone doesn't want to deliver that much. I do it. I'm a total professional. And that is the way I work. And that's what I want. So in that respect, I could be difficult to get along with. But I don't argue with my fellow actors. I mean, unless they're really impossible. And occasionally one or two of them are. But for the most part, I love really good actors. I hate blowhards.
Who's your favorite actor?
God, I don't know. I have several, and they're all Irish.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm married to an Irishman, so I might go along with that too. Yes.
Yeah. I love Daniel Day-Lewis and Liam Neeson and Stephen Ray. Those are my three faves. I'll sneak Harrison Ford in there a little bit.
Depending
I'll
on
bring him in. Oh, no, depending on nothing.
Just bring him in there. All right, he's good, period. Okay. Okay. No, this is the part that, just sitting here talking with you, you know, it's the age-old story of if you're candid, if you say how you feel, if you just are yourself.
Let it go.
Sometimes people want to, if you're not whatever it is that people think they want you to be.
Well,
you know?
Yes, and also people also want you to say what they want you to say. Right. And instead of, for example, now I just mentioned some actors. So why didn't I mention more American actors? Why did I mean, some columnists, I'm just using it as a ridiculous example because it would never happen, I don't think. But you know, why does she put down American actors? You know, I mean, everything can be distorted.
But you're not putting down American
no,
actors.
But to a columnist.
Yeah, I know.
Who wanted to find, just go around
the... But that's out of context. They take things out of context.
Constantly out of context. So it doesn't make any sense. So, I mean, listen, you can't fight them. Once once a story has been printed, there are two things that happen. If it's a monthly publication, the next month it's in the garbage, so it doesn't matter. No one remembers it. And they don't remember what's said half the time. They remember the names involved.
Isn't there an old saying they use the paper the next day to wrap the fish in or something like that?
And you cannot retaliate because they have, once it's been printed, all you can do is deny it. So that's a kind of weak position to be in. And this particular woman, it's not worth doing anything. I think she's cut her own throat because I'll tell you, she'll never work for any of those people again. That is for sure.
Well, we'll be looking forward to seeing that movie, won't we? Won't we know about the background?
You've got a fabulous cast.
It's a great idea. And you love Robert Altman. I know you do.
I love
John
Robert
Houston's
Altman.
Probably the only one you would love more, maybe.
And I absolutely love the actors in this movie are, for the most part, absolutely incredible. To be able to work with all of them is extraordinary. You have Mastroianni, not too bad.
How did he and Sophia get along?
Oh, he's wonderful. He is wonderful.
Go with him. Yeah, sure.
Excuse me?
Sophia Loren.
Oh, and Sophia. But she's fabulous.
Yeah, I know.
She's the most professional,
been here on the show.
You know, amusing, warm, friendly, easy, no airs, no baloney, and she's a real star.
Yeah.
She's
How
a
many
great
people
star.
Knew that, right?
No,
right.
But she's a great star.
Great lady.
She's not one of these stars who is just above everyone, you know, and
Couldn't you just bat somebody like that?
Well, I just don't want to have anything to do with anyone like that. I mean, they're not worth it because they don't last. Those people really don't last, you know. And this show, I mean, Julia Roberts is in this movie, and she's terrific. She is easy and mm-hmm. open and smart mm-hmm. and good. Mm-hmm. And so it's great to see a young woman like that. Mm-hmm. And it's great to see someone like Sophia who's been a... So what could be better than working with people like that? It's terrific.
But there should be roles for all women.
Yes, I mean, because, well, women of all ages have had problems for the last 10 years finding material. It has nothing to do with age anymore. It has to do with the fact that the writers are not writing parts.
We got to take a break here. You may have guessed this. They're
you can take a break.
Over there.
Oh, boy. I'm glad. I'm glad.
Well, now, let us read teleprompter here.
Okay, you go first.
Well, life on the road has got to be tough because you're always away. And while you're away, your children and your friends go on living independent lives. We're going to talk about the empty nest when we come back. Is that okay? Can we talk about that when we come back?
Absolutely,
the empty nest. They've come. And now I think you find as you get older, you want to pull them back in again a little bit more. But
sometimes.
Sometimes.
Sometimes you want to, like, tell them to get on, don't
you? Yeah, yeah.
Right. Okay.
We'll talk about that when we come back.
John Kelly, live in the Action Newsroom. Troy police have arrested a man in the shooting 3 days ago of a 19-year-old mother working alone in a Subway sandwich shop. It's known the man is a Troy resident. They hope later to arraign him today on Murder One charges. Late yesterday, a Deckerville man and his one-time live-in girlfriend were convicted of first-degree child abuse. The pair were arrested on Friday when police found Stephen Rogers' 9-year-old daughter chained to her bed. Good news and bad news on the labor front. The good news, Ford will expand its truck assembly plant in Norfolk, Virginia. For the second time in 2 years, that means more jobs. Bad news, Michigan National Bank today means less jobs. They've announced a cutoff of 1,000 positions. The sun comes out later. Seize the day. More later. Back to company.
If you had your choice of everybody in the world, which would you rather marry? A rich guy or a poor one?
I think I'd rather marry a rich one.
All right, then, where would you be more likely to meet a rich one? In a walk up on Amsterdam Avenue or in a joint like this?
Well, I should say in a joint like this.
Okay, then that's it. We're all working steady, so we throw everything we make into the kitty and get a little organization into this marriage caper. Class address, class background, class characters. To be specific about it, nothing under 6 figures a year.
I've never heard anything so intelligent in my life.
Well, if you want to catch a mouse, you set a mouse trap. So, all right, we set a bear trap. Now, all we've got to do is one of us has got to knock off a bear.
You mean marry him?
Well, if you don't marry him, you haven't caught him. He's caught you.
How to Marry a Millionaire. I've got that movie. I love it.
That's fun, isn't it?
Oh,
yeah, I love that. I had a great time in that movie.
Okay, who caught who? Did he catch you or?
Who what?
Did Bogey catch you or did you catch Bogey?
Oh, I don't know. I suppose in a way, well, I mean, he certainly captured me, but I suppose in a way I got him because he was married. I wasn't.
Oh, there's a revelation.
But, he was really not in a good situation at all. But it just happened. I don't know. I guess it was just totally mutual capitulation.
Did it take him a long time to get out of that situation?
About a year.
Did it?
Well, he wasn't a man who left easily. He wasn't a man who fooled around. He didn't believe in that. And he was a real gent. And although his wife at the time was really a difficult woman and had serious problems, and caused him a lot of, you know, additional problems, he still felt he just couldn't leave her, you know, without giving her enough of a chance to straighten out. But she couldn't straighten out, so a year was okay. It was difficult, but okay. Finally, it was perfect.
And the rest is history, right? You know, you and Humphrey Bogart had two children together.
Would you like to speak up?
Can you hear me?
Miss, well, you're whispering into the mic.
What's wrong with our system around here?
Y'all right over there, honey? You okay? I'll leave Crosby and help you if you need it. You all right
How
over there?
How am I doing?
Okay, you're okay. You're okay.
You don't have to shout. You have a microphone, but all I hear is this.
I'll tell you, this lady, wow. I know now she's not going to sign my book. You had two kids together. And you made it your business to have children come first with the children. And then you did it again when you had Sam with Jason Robards.
Yes.
That was your decision. Have you ever regretted that? I mean, did you miss good roles that you...
Oh, I missed many, yes.
Did you?
I think my career definitely suffered. But I made a choice with Bogey because that was part of our agreement. We made a deal, and he would not marry me if I put work first and went off on location, you know, whenever a good part came along. And as a result, was separated from him in our home. And I agreed to that because he'd had a rough time, the marriage before, and he'd never had children. He'd never really had a family life. And I really wanted to give him that, and I did. And certainly in view of the fact that our marriage lasted such a short time, I'm totally thrilled that I stuck to that agreement. And although I had many frustrating moments because I didn't get parts that I would have liked to have had, still he wanted me with him.
What part did you miss during that time that went on to
be? Oh, I don't know. I don't know offhand. But I mean, there were parts I would have liked to have had. But I wasn't thought of. It was a very curious thing. The minute I married Bogey, I was thought of as Bogey's wife. They decided that I didn't take my career seriously, that was it. And listen, what can you do? Can't fight City Hall. Just have to go along with it. And I was able to keep my name alive enough so that I've always been able to work. But it certainly has been an uphill climb because of that.
Any of the kids in the business?
Excuse me?
Any of the kids in the business?
Yes, my young son, Sam Robards, is an actor. A wonderful one and a great-looking guy.
He is, and there's the...
Do you find as time goes on that motherhood sort of has to play a background role, that you sort of have to fade into the background as your kids are getting older and growing up and marrying and having children?
What do you mean by fade into the background? I don't know what
I think
you mean.
You have to, your role completely changes from the time they're in their 20s, and it changes when they're in their 30s.
Well, of course. I mean, as they get on with their own lives, they don't need you in the same way. They need you always to be there in the background, mm-hmm. but they want to get on with their own lives, as probably you and you did, and I certainly did. You forge ahead with what you want to do, and... mother and, you know, your parents in the background, but always there, better always be there when they're needed. I didn't consciously do anything, really, except I kept working. As a matter of fact, half the time, my children don't know where I am because I'm traveling so much. And it wouldn't do me any good to want to hang on to their lives because I couldn't. I brought them up to be independent, and they are. And I'm independent. So we get, I mean, you know, we have great relationships and we're in constant contact. And I mean, a couple of weeks go by at the most, usually, before, we're always in touch. We always at least speak on the phone.
Was it not different with Leslie, but was it the mother-daughter, maybe I'm a little closer to my little girl than the boys, or... In the book, you talk about a lot of times, I know these aren't the right words, she's your confidant, maybe she's the one that you call on a lot during moments that might be a little stressful for you, or she's the one you're...
Well, she's telling. The one that I did a lot. I must say, I threw an awful lot of stuff at her sometimes, because obviously, being another female, you know, you have a certain understanding of one another. But then, again, there's always a mother-daughter friction. I mean, there is always the state of affairs where the daughter is trying to find her own identity and not be her mother and not be her mother's daughter, but she wants to be herself. Everybody wants to be themselves. But I've always been close to her, and we've always had a little, because she, you know, I want her to do what I want her to do. She wants to do what she wants to do, and she does what she wants to do.
When you were planning her wedding, because she married at around 37 or so,
yes,
was that difficult then when your sons were married? Were there some other little twinges or feelings that came in with her marriage, planning
her
marriage?
It was totally different, for one thing, because I had to give the wedding. With sons, you don't. You're just a guest. That's fabulous.
You had all the plans.
No. But with daughters, you give the wedding. And she didn't understand that, really. She kind of thought that she and her husband-to-be would do the whole thing together. And I was to be just stand on the outside and write the check. I don't know.
But that's not what you did.
So we had a couple of moments of strain and stress between us. Little tug of war there. We're opposing wills. But finally, it worked out very well. And she's happy, and I'm really happy for her, because she's very lucky to have found somebody that she really wants to spend her life with.
Well, we are going to take questions and answers later on in the show, so don't think that we've forgotten you out here, because we'd rather you ask the question sometimes than us. You know, you write a lot about loss in your book, and with all of us, we've all lost a lot of good friends along the way. And Mr. Bogart, your mom, your friend Leonard Bernstein. So when we come back, we hope that you'll talk to us a little bit about coping with loss. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, thank you. We're moving.
Relationship with an angel? Have you been visited by one, or maybe you're in contact with one now? If you believe in angels and have a good story to tell, call 810-827-9336.
You think I'd ever let them know where you were?
Could be.
That's why you won't tell me.
Yes, that's why.
No, it isn't. You won't tell me because you think I'll come there. You think I'd follow you.
You'd be insane to follow me.
Was I insane to pick you up on the road? Was I crazy to let you stay here?
My word! Good heavens! I better see that movie again. I haven't seen it in years.
You know, you became a widow at 31, some would say, you know, rather early. And just the losses in your life, can you talk with us a little bit, I guess just giving hope to any of us who've lost people? You talked about earlier letting go, not living in the past. But these people we lose, we miss.
Yes, and also, well, also people that have had an impact on your life, which are either, if it's a husband or your mother, certainly, or friends, you never forget. And that's why I wrote about my friends in particular. I wrote about Bogie and my mother in my first book. But I think that you just, I mean, obviously you learn to live with it, but it's, you know, no matter what concert I ever go to, I see Lenny Bernstein standing on the podium. It doesn't matter who the conductor is, because he was such an enormous, enormous talent, personality and everything combined, that if you were a friend of his and knew him and had witnessed his conducting various, whether concerts, excuse me, or operas or whatever, you could never forget it. And so in a way, they always come back to you. Mm-hmm. It's, I mean, Houston, for example, I mean, I'm a friend of Angelica Houston. And I love her. And of course, obviously, there is always a connection. And that's good. That makes you feel good. It's terrible to lose a friend, someone that you've been close to. But if they have really affected your life in a positive way, you never lose them, really, because that kind of affecting you stays with you. If they each changed me at different times in my life. And so for that reason alone, they're with me wherever I go.
You also talked about before some of them died, you feel you've got like ESP. Something happens with you the night before.
Yes, a very, very odd thing. Well, I don't think I have ESP, except I wonder about it occasionally, because I remember that I always suddenly started to focus continually, like for a 24-hour period, on a friend who had been ill. And they died. And I never could kind of come to terms with reasoning that, but I suddenly realized that that's what happened. And I just kind of knew that something was going to happen. And I have no explanation for it because I sound like a nut, but...
You sound like you're psychic.
Sound like a psychic? Psychic. I'm not a... Please, I'm not
a
psychic.
You don't like that stuff.
Please, I am not the psychic. No.
Ever gone to a psychic?
I don't think I have any extraterrestrial talent.
Terrestrial?
No,
Lauren,
I don't.
We've got a lot of people in the audience, and they really want to talk to you. So we're going to start doing it now, okay? You had a question for
her? Yes, I'm a movie buff, and I was watching an old movie called The Gang. The Gang is Here, and I was wondering if I saw a woman in there that was dancing with somebody, and it wasn't you.
No.
It was a beautiful young woman, and I could have sworn
well,
it was
thank
you.
Thank you, but I don't even know the movie. No, I have no idea.
The Gang's All Here. It was Carmen Miranda. It was a 20th Century Fox movie.
Sorry, no.
Well, I know it was the wrong studio. It wasn't Warner Brothers. No, she was just in the...
No.
On the dance floor. I just thought maybe it might have been you.
No, no, because that would have been an extra. I've never been an extra. No, I never...
Well, you were a star the minute you walked on screen.
Why, thank you. No.
Stage struck.
excuse me. I was wondering how you feel seeing clippings of yourself and Bogey.
Excuse me?
I was wondering how you feel seeing, like, the clippings of you and Bogey. Is it just another part of your life, or does it bring up memories, and is it painful, you know, with your loss?
Well, no, it certainly was another part of my life, but it was a gigantic part of my life, and it's a part of my life that I will carry with me all of my days, because no one had the impact on me except for my mother that he had. So, I mean, I'm not casual about it at all. I just want recognition for the fact that I have lived for 35 years without him and have done things on my own.
And you also have this brave question on behalf of the audience. Answer it. Ask it real quick.
Well, I'm from Canada, and I brought my book for signing.
I just came from Canada.
Oh, you did?
Toronto.
You could have come over. No. I was just wondering if it's all possible to have it passed up to have it signed.
Signed? Sure.
Oh, thank you very much.
You ask it, okay? Thanks. Marilyn?
Yeah, having played in How to Marry a Millionaire, Marilyn Monroe, could you give us a short opinion of what you think of her? And also, I would like to know what month you were born. Thank you.
Oh, are you going to tell me something about what's going to happen to me? No? Well, I was born in September, actually. I will not discuss the year. Marilyn was, she was very, very nice. She was a very sweet young woman and very kind of lost and very self-involved. But not in a nasty way at all. She had no meanness in her. She was just, she was fine. We got along very well, actually. I had no problems with her, nor she with me.
She wasn't hard to work with on the set?
No. The only thing that was hard about her was that she was late almost all the time. But she was late not because she wanted to be late, but because she really had a difficult time facing everyone, you know? I mean, she took a long, long time being made up, and not that she needed it, but that was the only fault that I could really find with her. She really was lacking in confidence. She just had, she had a coach on the set all the time, which was sometimes difficult, but as far as dealing with her directly, it wasn't a problem.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Okay, Ms. Bacall. She's not listening.
Okay. Yes,
I've enjoyed your whole career. Your first book, By Myself, you didn't have a ghostwriter or anything. Is this
not
one
on
the
your
same
life.
Way?
Not on your life.
I enjoyed that very much by
Thank
myself.
You. No, no ghostwriters in my life. I write everything myself for good or ill.
And I don't have a book with me, but I have a copy of Casablanca. Would you sign your name on it for me?
I wasn't in Casablanca.
I know, but he was. He was.
Why do people keep wanting to connect me with Casablanca?
He was. I associate you with him.
Oh, we talked about that. Okay.
Isn't that funny? Yeah.
It's so funny. I had an argument with a woman once. It was funny. I was on tour with a show, and I was sitting in a restaurant, and some woman came up to me with the record of Casablanca, asked me to sign it. And I said, well, I'll sign it, but I wasn't in it. And she said, yes, you were.
And
said, no, I wasn't. And she said, yes, you were.
Yes, you were.
And I said, unless I'm Ingrid Bergman, I was not in it. And she went, oh.
Isn't that wild? Isn't that wild? Well, Hollywood has come a long way from a time when sex scenes were simply innuendo. Let's talk about your views on Hollywood today when we come back, okay?
Is there someone you're going to see at Thanksgiving dinner that you need to impress? A new mother-in-law, an ex-husband, or someone who thought you'd never lose the weight, find another man, or get your act together? We're doing I Told You So makeovers. So call us now and tell us who you need to look good for this holiday season. Call 810-827-9336.
John Kelly live in the Action Newsroom. Troy police are holding a man they think shot and killed a 19-year-old mother who was clerking a Subway shop overnight 4 days ago. Later today, the cops are going for a murder one warrant. A woman who is accused of stabbing a 13-year-old pregnant daughter wants the daughter back. Police say the woman, herself pregnant, whipped the girl with the telephone, then stabbed at her hands, chest, and head with a 10-inch knife. The woman was angry, they say, over the teen's pregnancy. In Lapeer County, officials have seized 169 puppies and 25 cats from a couple's 80-acre farm. It's charged that a puppy mill was operating there under very bad conditions. Eric Smith and Robbie Timmons at midday. I'll be there, too, on Kelly's Corner. Back to company.
And her tears flowed like wine.
Yes, her tears flowed like wine.
She's a real sad tomato.
She's a busted valentine.
Knows her
mama done told her
that a man is darned unkind. I'm a telling you, mister.
I'm telling you, mister.
She was a sob, sob sister.
Sob, sob sister.
Lying on a pillow.
Weeping like a willow.
My, oh my, how that baby could cry.
And her tears flowed like wine.
Yes, her tears flowed like wine.
Oh! What a sound.
Lauren, how has things changed for women in Hollywood from, say, 30 years ago until now?
Well, they've changed enormously. Number one, 30 years ago, women really were the leaders. You have Betty Davis and Katherine Hepburn and Garbo and Greer Garson.
And Bacall.
Barbara Stanwyck. And, I mean, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful actresses and great stars. And now, also, it was very cohesive. It was very concentrated. The studio system really was a very positive thing because of that. And people were writing roles for women. Nowadays, of course, people are not writing roles for women, and for the last 10 or 15 years, they certainly have not been, for women of all ages. As you know, that women have a terribly hard time finding parts to play. Jane Fonda stopped, you know, acting in movies several years ago because she couldn't find a decent part. And you keep lots of, Jessica Lange had problems, mm-hmm. Streep had problems, lots and lots of really, actresses in their 40s and 50s had problems. And in their 30s have problems getting a decent part. It's all about guys, you know? All these guys together, Stallone, Paul Schwarzenegger,
Clint Eastwood. Clint Eastwood, right?
Ah, Clint.
Yeah, yeah, I know you do like him, I know.
Clint, I love Clint. He's special, but he likes younger women. But I do like him.
Oh, yes. We could always like them, even if they don't even see us, right?
Yeah, right, I know.
Right. Nikki?
Got a question behind you.
Miss Bacall, I've already told you you're such an inspiration, and my mom and I were talking about the difference of the classics. I mean, the women you mentioned, including yourself, are so, I mean, class, and now it's so different with the action and, I guess, the drugs and all of that. What's your opinion of, I guess, a different style, and how can we get those movies back where they're just so real?
Ah, well, I'm very happy to hear you ask that question because it's a fight, you know. I don't want to see another naked person on screen myself. So boring. Yeah, I mean, no, I mean, it's not that I'm a prude, it's just that I think they're so boring.
I don't want to see Michael Douglas drop his drawers again. I mean, it's just too dreary. And I just think that nothing is left to the imagination. The terrible thing that's happened to me, in my view, in movies, is that people are not allowed to use their imagination anymore. Everything is so graphic. Everything is spelled out for you. You see everything. You see how the explosions happen. You see how all special effects take place. I mean, it's a pain in the neck. That's why we've stopped thinking in our society, because we are not allowed to think. And there's no way to get the movies back because you can't get the same people back. But there certainly is a way to improve them. And hopefully now that we have this new studio group getting together now of Spielberg and who else? Dave Geffen and Katzenberg. Hopefully, maybe they will be innovative and start bringing back really solid, good movies. I mean, I'm in favor of it. And maybe there'll be a part for me, a walk-on or something. I can carry a truck.
You've never done a walk-on.
No, but I will now.
Okay, that's called being open and changing, right, and adapting. But every Friday, I know you don't know this, every Friday on the show we do something called Pet of the Week, where we help find an animal a home. And we know that Blenheim, your dog, was real special to you. So we want to ask, do you mind just sticking around for the next segment when we find this pet for this puppy?
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, not pet, owner for the puppy.
Yes.
You'll stay?
Yes, I will.
Thank you.
Oh, I will.
We'll
will.
Be right back.
Syndicated columnist Linda Hirsch is coming to Company to dish the dirt that's on your favorite soap stars. Plus, a surprise soap celebrity will stop by to share why life is a soap opera. For free tickets to the show, call 810-827-9336. This portion of Company, Pet of the Week, is brought to you by PVH. Open 24 hours, 7 days a week, with 15 convenient locations.
Call, and this
who
is
would not want this
week.
Dog?
Isn't he adorable?
Who and would not just, want you?
He just said if he won't grow anymore, you'll catch him.
I think he's yours now.
He's 9 weeks old, and he's at the Central Shelter of Michigan Humane Society. And if you're interested in giving him a good home, call 872-3400.
You have to. Somebody has to give this dog a home.
Oh, definitely. This
somebody
show,
has to give you a home.
This dog will have a home in about another half hour.
Every Friday, the dog that's featured on here usually gets a home, so
but
we do real
sure
well
they get
this.
A good home.
Now, that's the
you're never really sure of that. You're never really sure, but we ask a lot of questions. We don't want dogs returned, like recycled, you know, like they think animals
Well, we want to thank Ms. Bacall for being
into
here.
That.
Have a good weekend. Don't forget the
Thanks
book, Lauren Bacall Now. Thanks a lot. See you Monday.
Hairstyles and makeup for Marilyn, Nikki, and their guests provided by Robin Manoogian of About Face, located in Palazzolo Salon in downtown Royal Oak. Video cassettes of Company are available for $19 through SOS Transcripts. Call 1-800-553-7717. That's 1-800-553-7717.